Hi guys, Craig Rivers here. So I'm gonna do a little cooking video today, and basically, it's not really catch and cook video, but it's kind of like, well, I hunt something. This is the byproduct of what I hunt. It's actually a deer heart. Here it is. It's kind of nasty looking. The looks are what makes it bad, but hearts are actually very good to eat. If you've had wild turkey, you'll notice how gamey and tough wild turkey is. But heart is, if you go through history and read some of the things about cannibalism and people that like, one story in particular, it was, I think it was the story that inspired Moby Dick. It was about these guys that were lost at sea. They're on a life raft. People were starving and dying, and they unfortunately had to cannibalize the people. And the first thing they ate was the heart. And when I have lion kills around here that kill deer, there's two things that they go for first, and it's the heart and the liver, because of the high protein, because the lion instinctively doesn't know if it's going to make it back to the carcass. So it wants to utilize as much protein as it can. And so I guess what I'm saying is heart is a good byproduct of deer hunting or whatever you're eating. And the thing about it is, and I think this is probably why they went for the heart at first with cannibalism, is that it's not gamey at all. And it's really tender. So what I'm gonna basically do is show you how I cook a heart. And up at deer camp, we always ate them for breakfast at breakfast time. A lot of people eat liver and onions. I never was very good about eating liver and onions. I just don't care for liver that much. But so basically what I did was I sliced the heart in half, and there's some big cavities in here. So what you wanna do is you wanna trim all this muscle fat off of here, get rid of that, get it cleaned up. So get rid of all this stuff. It's real easy to cook. I mean, there's no problem with cooking it at all. And actually, I like it. Now, the trick to cooking heart is you basically cook it like you would cook fish. And so there I got all the fat and everything trimmed off. Once you have it, see, there's the heart shape. Once you have it, you slice it in strips, and like you would an orange, you know, from top to bottom, and you make strips like so. And then actually you can kind of trim that up a little bit better once you've sliced those strips. I know there's people that are going to be squeamish. And if you have family members that just don't like the idea of eating heart, the thing is not to cut it up in front of them. Don't let them see it. Wait till it's cooked, then present it to them. You know, make it look nice, present it to them, let them try a piece. I think they'll be in for a surprise. So basically, I fillet it like that. Now, what I usually do, and what I forgot to do, is I rinse the blood off. So if you give me a minute, I'm gonna walk over to the faucet and rinse some of this off. There I usually rinse it before I fillet it. Really don't have to, there's not that much blood in it. Look out, dog. So, the problem with deer hunting is everybody seems to aim for the heart. The problem is you waste, not only do you waste the heart, but you run the risk of blowing up the guts and making a mess out of the deer. I try to, I was taught to, try to shoot them in the neck. And then that way they bleed out and the heart is nice and clean. Now when you cut the heart, you'll always find a bit of a blood clot in there. Don't worry about that. Just rinse that out, wash that out, get rid of that, and go from there. So basically what I do, now you can cook a heart any way you want, just like I said, just like fish. And you can roll it in cracker crumbs, you can just put it in flour. You can cook it with potatoes, you can cook it with onions and potatoes. You can dice it up and make pretty much anything you want out of it. That's quite a bit of meat there. So, what I'm gonna do is I have a little bit of pancake batter, which is kind of works good for like doing fish and whatnot. And so I'm gonna put it in some pancake batter. Get my stove lit here. Might need a windbreak. Breezy here. So, the best thing, of course, is olive oil or vegetable oil, lard, anything you got. You could even render some of the fat down from the deer and make some oil. You know, if you're in a survival mode. And a lot of people say that deer, if you're starving deer, is not going to feed you very good. Well, that's not true. There's fat on deer. I mean, there's, you know, it's not like you're going to get rabbit starvation from deer. So I put a fair amount of olive oil in here. I also had a little bit of bacon grease left over, so I put that in there. So basically you take your pancake batter and add some water. Kind of tricky to get the right consistency. More water than that. Hmm. I guess you make it about the consistency you would if you were making pancakes. And the other thing you can do, you know, if it doesn't stick well or work well, you can put put it in the grease, cook it a little bit, then drop it in there again, and then double coat it. It should be pretty good. So what I have is I made my own kind of an adobo spice, and I like to put it in the batter. It's kind of like getting French fries, seasoned French fries. It's a pretty good flavor. Mix it a little bit better. So you get it all mixed up. Almost looks like potato chip dip. The only thing about this is, you know, if you're gonna do this in the field, all you need is a little bag, plastic bag of flour. It's an old stove. Everything I've had for years. Okay. Little steak seasoning of any kind will work. Oh yeah. Let the grease get a little bit hotter. Oh yeah. See, look at that. Nice and coated. Oh yeah, that's gonna be pretty darn good. Oop, did that wrong backwards. So the other thing I've noticed is I've noticed it with quite a few people that do bushcraft and survival shows and cook and catch and cook and whatnot, or just cooking. They'll cook a piece of chicken, get it nice and done, and then they put it back on the tray or the cutting board that they worked on it with. And you can't do that. You just cannot do that. Please do not do that. You will make yourself sick. I read an article about a Boy Scout that picked a little piece of burger up off of the corner of the grill because he was so hungry. A little piece of hamburger. He ended up in the hospital. He almost died. And the problem was, is he was going to space camp. And he was worried about missing space camp, so his mom gave him some kind of thing, medication that, you know, slows you down when you have the runs and you're sick. And what that did is that kept the bug and the germ inside of him instead of him getting rid of it like he should have. And he damn near died. So you gotta be careful. And you cook chicken. Don't put it back on the package that you got it from in the store. Just, you know, put it somewhere else. Oop. I'm not sure the stove will get hot enough to cook this the way I want it. Oh, well, I'll just let it go. See what happens. With deer and beef, you don't have to worry about it so much, but chicken, I would be careful with chicken, and I would be careful with pork for sure. Beef doesn't seem to bother me when it's really raw. Like I said before, liver's a little bit rich for me. I love it, like liver and onions. But holy smokes, it makes me, it's too rich for me. I sweat and I get sick. And so. Yeah, it's not getting brown. There we go. Yeah, see, it looks like fish and chips. I think I made those pieces too big. Yep, stay put. Go again with the road noise. Don't people work? I have to apologize for that. There's not much I can do about it. It gets, for me, it's very irritating. I might even be able to cut that out. I don't know, but there's a lot of editing to do to deal with the sound and the noise. Earlier today, I started later on because earlier today, some dork across the street was running a blower. What the heck do you blow around out in the country for? All you do is make dust. I don't get it. Well, it's kind of falling apart. That's all right. I never had any luck cooking fish either, have it all stay on the fish. Yep. Box is hot. Oh, I know what I forgot. Steak spice. There we go. What the heck happened to the dog? I know he's around here scrounging up crumbs. Cooking. Not real pretty. All the batter fell off quite a bit of the chunks, but that's all right. Get a couple good chunks out of there. Never really tried putting it on a stick and roasting it, but that might be pretty good too. My favorite parts of the deer are the heart and the back straps and the tenderloins. And it's all pretty good meat for making, you know, good meals. And the backstrap, I almost hate wasting it to make jerky, but boy, does it make some good jerky. And also you can cut it up squares and put it on shish kebabs. And deer hunting can be, in our area, is actually sustainable. There's a lot of deer and a lot of private land that doesn't get hunted. So there's plenty of deer around. And it does supplement your cost of groceries and food and whatnot if you got a family. I knew a guy that had a family of six, and if he didn't hunt, I mean, they would go hungry. See, that's what I was talking about in one of my other videos. Those guys just went up the road not too long ago, and now they're going back down the road. What the heck? Can't they go somewhere else to ride? If they want to ride fast, go ride on the freeway. Kind of like the joke of my family. You want to play, go play on the freeway. Now, kind of a mess going over there, but I got a couple of good pieces right here. Yep. Shut up. That rooster don't quit attacking my wife. I'm gonna wring his neck. Think about throwing them in the, I got one of these new, pressure cookers and, men grills, I think it is. I might just have to stuff him in there and see how he tastes. Beautiful rooster, but he's a jerk. Definitely gonna have to grab him and cut his spurs off. I don't want him hurting my granddaughter. Finally quiet. I'm so sorry about the traffic noise. You'd think with a 100-acre ranch you could get away from it. I might have to, like I said before, I might have to move a bush camp up to the side of the hill, or maybe go over the hill. And so I can get away from some of the noise. It's impossible to film with the noise around here. Problem is the weather's good. And once the weather's good, people come out of the woodwork. Well, I think that we're about ready to try a piece of this. Thank you. shut up anytime now. Because I'd rather hear that than traffic. Some of this fell apart. What it was is I moved it too quick. Oh well, all those crumbs and all those bacon pieces will be good. We'll look at these onions. Look at the onions here. I don't know if you can see that, but that's good. Okay. Let's try a piece of this. Shut up. I'm so sorry. I might have to do this video over. It's just crazy. What the heck's he crowing about? It's the middle of the day. I don't think you guys can see my dog, but my dog's sitting right here. A little bit crunchy on this one. Oop. You can pick it up with the fork. Not as tender as usual. I may have cooked it a little bit too long trying to get the batter done on it. It's good. Nice piece. Good. Yep. That's the way to do it, guys. Well, okay. I don't know if there's anything I can add. Just thank you for watching my video. It's a little bit of a short video, but yeah, definitely. If you get your hands on a deer heart, or like I said, gamey turkeys and whatnot, the heart on a turkey is that big around. That's like a meatball, and they're really good. And so if you do a bunch of turkeys, make sure you grab the hearts out of them. And like I said, there are other things you can do with them. You can dice them up, cook them with potatoes, and make kind of like a hash. A good recipe is dice them up like in 3-inch or 1/4-inch cubes, onions, sliced potatoes, and throw some corn in there. And make kind of like a hash. And that's like old school outdoor food. We used to eat things like that all the time when we're out in the woods because it's so easy. And, you can carry around a can of corn with you. And I guess you could even use dried corn or whatever. The thing I don't get about people is that you read about all these backpackers and people that are out in the woods, and they're eating health foods. Why? Eat health foods. You only go out in the woods like once a month or once every 6 months, once a year. Eat health foods the rest of your life so you're healthy. And then when you go out in the woods, eat good food and comfort foods and steak and get some protein and some carbs on you so that you can move and walk and hike. I'm not going to hike 20 miles and eat granola bars and dried junky food. I'm going to eat good food. It's a little harder to carry good food because it weighs a little bit more than some of the custom backpacking foods that they have today. But if you plan it out, you can figure out how to do it. And anyway, that's just kind of my take. I mean, I guess if you want to eat health food when you hike 20 miles, fine, go ahead. But in fact, I knew this when I was younger because my mom went through a health food kick. And actually, I wasn't that much younger, but I was working hard around the ranch. And then she'd say, I got a Greek salad and, you know, a tuna fish sandwich for you with sprouts. And it's like, man, was it good. Because my mom could cook, and I love Greek salads. But it didn't last. I mean, I would go out, and I'm humping poles and fence posts and stuff and moving junk around. And it's like, Mom, I'm hungry. You're going to have to bring me out some more food, like, I don't know, cheese and crackers, something, just to kind of get me through the day. So anyway, again, pretty darn good. So on that note, I guess I will see you in the next video. Like I said, I got a lot of ideas and a lot of videos I want to do. And I will catch up with you next time. So see you later. Bye now.